Amen. Extended unto us. How good it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Oh, bless us today, oh Father. Open our hearts and our minds. Give us a revelation, knowledge, that we might know your will in our life. Amen to God, and the path that we take. Bless the churches everywhere, the people of God across the land, standing for you, oh God. Help us be a witness in all that we say and do. Amen. And bless our little church here, oh God. and the church and everywhere where men are standing for you today. We thank you for it, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Wasn't it just good to be in the house of God? Praise the Lord. And Judy's here. She comes singing. Get her singing. Praise the Lord. Good to see you, young man.
Yeah, now it is. My heavenly home is
oh,
Luke chapter 6. We'll be reading from 39 to 49. Chapter 6. 39.
Can you hear me?
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Okay. And y'all there say amen.
Amen.
Thank you. And he spoke a parable unto them. Can the blind lead the blind, shall they not both fall into the ditch?
The disciple is not above his master, but every one that is perfect shall be as his master.
And why beholdest thou the mote in thy brother's eye, but perceivest not the beam that is in thine own eye?
Neither how canst thou say to thy brother, Brother, let me pull out the mote that is in thine eye, and thou thyself beholdest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Thou hypocrite, cast thou first the beam out of thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly, pour out the mote that is in thy brother's eye.
For a good tree bringeth not forth corrupt fruit, neither does a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit.
For every tree is known by his own fruit. For our thorns men do not gather figs, nor gather grapes.
A good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth that which is good, and an evil man out of the evil treasures of his heart brings forth that which is evil. For of the abundance of the heart his mouth speaketh.
And why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say?
Whosoever cometh to me and heareth my sayings and doeth them, I will show you to whom he is like.
He is like a man which built an house and dig deep and laid the foundation on a rock, and when the flood arose, the stream beat him upon the house and could not shake it, for it was founded upon the rock.
But he that heareth and doeth not is like a man that is without a foundation, built in the house upon the earth, against which the stream did beat. Yeah. And immediately it fell, and the rain, the ruin of the house was great. That's a big word. That's a stupid
thing. That's a God.
I'm
serve the Lord. I know our postal workers are sure glad yesterday's over. And them postal people had a tough time with it too. Let me tell you, trying to get their route done and get them. And they said they had extra heavy mail. Now, I mean, they did. One girl, they said, didn't even get a route started at 3 o'clock.
They told me, I asked them about it, and they said that the other day, said they won't let them come in as early as they used to. They're making them come in late.
Oh, I see.
Of course, yesterday was extraordinary, I understand.
Yeah, it was. I've heard them say that it's tough to get it done in 8 hours, you know. I've told a story about the girl that I spoke with my brother's funeral, and she was telling, she said a lot of people didn't know what kind of a guy Stanley Davis was, but he knew she was new on the job, and she was a single mother, you know, and she was trying to raise a child, and she just wasn't cut on getting the mail delivered. She just couldn't do it. She couldn't get her route done. And so he decided he was going to help her. And so he just took it upon himself. He'd go out and hunt her up towards the end of getting down towards the end of the ship, find out where she was at, and take half her mail and say, here, give me half of that. And he'd go deliver that for her. And little by little, he gave her tips and showed her how to get faster and so on. And she got, I remember at his funeral, she got up, she just cried. She said, I would never been able to get my job. Hadn't been for Stanley Davis, so he didn't get a nickel for it. And he spent days and days working with me like that. My own supervisor didn't help me like that. But that's the kind of guy he was. He did a lot of things people didn't know about. But I know they have cut down to the point it's just hard to even get around for the route, the regular route they had, let alone now packing home and groceries stuff. And what was it, 11,000?
Over 11,000 pounds.
And that's the most in the head. So, and it'll help a lot of people. And you know, a lot of people don't know all it goes into trying to help people before you even, you know, see any results for whatsoever. But we thank the Lord for everything that was done and all those who were able and did so. And God will bless you. You cannot outgive God. And he'll prove that to you over and over and over. And some of them say, I wish I had, but there was some said, thank God I made it. You know, I got it done. Praise the Lord. And somebody's going to get a reward. Did you know that?
Yes.
There's your reward. It's going to be rewards handed out in heaven. Yes. Amen. And it won't be to the one that said, well, I wish I had. It'll be somebody that saw it through. I don't know if I can do this or not. But I'm going to get my best shot, you know. Amen. And that's what it's all about. Praise the Lord. I want to get into this. I've been all over the 6th and 7th chapters of Luke the last couple of weeks. And I can't seem to get past it. And it just stays right with me. So I just kind of want to just go in. But so I'm going to read it. I think I may go up and read. No, I'll wait on that. I'll start at the 39th verse of St. Luke. And he spake a parable unto them. And you know, we talked about him speaking in parables last week. Can the blind lead the blind? Shall they not both fall in the ditch? Well, it's amazing what blind people can do. We were talking about that this morning. We were talking about Russell Mouton. Same thing, I know Russell. I knew Russell for years and years. He was a blind man, and he tuned pianos. He worked for a Rome music company in Bloomington, Indiana. And he tuned pianos, and he repaired pianos. He repaired guitars. He was quite an amazing man. And he used to come to church, and he'd play that violin, and he'd just drive me crazy with it, because I can get them sweet, beautiful notes out of it, he can. Mine's always got it. If it's ball and cabbage, it's not too bad. But if it's a Tennessee waltz, it will make you cry. In fact, it had our cat in the neighborhood crying. I couldn't learn to play because I can't stand it. Listen to myself practice. It's the truth. Used to in the clubs once a night, I get the fiddle out and I play Ball of Cabbage and maybe the background rag. And if everybody was really good and drunk, I'd play the Orange Blossom Special. Of course, I couldn't drink. I still had to suffer through. But Russell was quite a guy for a blind man. I remember I came to Sister Betty's one night and I said, Russell, have you got a pig? He said, yeah, I got this yellow one. And he handed it to me. And I walked away and I got thinking, how do you know that was yellow? Somebody got a tail in it, it was yellow. And then somebody told me this morning, maybe that's all he's ever bought, yellow pigs. As you knew Russell, he had a real odd sense of humor, ironic kind of a sense of humor. He would do something like that just to get you going. He'd buy yellow pigs just because he just loved to tease you. He was on me all the time. He was after me all the time. But he was he could play Water Through the Head of Jesus and Have You Crying. I mean, he could really play the violin and the guitar. He had a guitar one night, and he worked at a music store. He could bring in him, he wanted. And he said, how you like this blonde baby, Pat? It was a big old Gibson guitar, a blonde Gibson guitar. And again, I thought, now how did he know that was blonde? And he was quite a guy. He would crawl around under the piano, and he changed those strings by feel. He felt everything. And he could change strings. He could repair anything on the piano. And he did, and guitars, and all kinds of, he was just quite a guy to know. But, so, it says here, can the blind lead the blind? This is a very simple thing that he's putting forth. If you don't know which way you're going, how are you going to tell somebody which way to go? That's what it's saying. If you don't know the way, how are you going to tell anybody the way? Well, you know, we're in this to find out what we're doing and where we're going. Somewhere along the line, we're supposed to come to the understanding of what we're trying to do here. We're not just beating at the air. We're doing something that's positive and we'll bring forth results. And that result that the Lord wants to see is changes in men's lives. He wants to change your life. He wants you to be converted. In fact, he said, except you be converted, you shall in no wise enter in. Amen. You've got to be converted. There's things in life that has to be changed to be converted. Hallelujah. If you're going to burn a bottle of gas on a gas stove, you've got to make some changes. They got a conversion kit you can get. And put it on there, it'll change it over and it'll burn that gas. But if you put it back to natural gas, you want to make some changes again. That's what you got to do. And to do the work of the Lord, we have to make some changes. And there's people who actually think they're going to go through life like they are and make it in. Now, if you didn't need to be changed, the Lord would have saved you. And He saved you, and He gave you the earnest of your inheritance, but He's wanting you to come into an inheritance.
Amen.
He's wanting you to find a better way. There's a better way.
Amen.
You ever watch people, all they know how to do is scream at each other. They have no idea how to talk anything out. They have no idea how to work anything through. All they can do is scream. You ever see families like that?
Yes.
And that first service, so they're normal. That's the way they do things. It just drives you crazy. It does me. And now we're getting that more and more now. Now the women, they're screaming and fighting just as much as the men. Now, used to the men did most of that.
Teenagers
are the worst. Oh, the teenagers are the worst. It's getting the worst. It's hard to just, who wants to go to the mall? I mean, really, it's really, it's just a war zone. It's just a war. They're having their way. You know, they're getting it done. It's amazing. It's amazing how so few people can control such a great multitude. But if the multitude don't came back, then they're going to have their way.
Amen.
Amen. And it's getting worse and worse. But the disciple is not above his master. You know, someone said one time, well, I'm a child of the king. I deserve the best. And I said, well, the king didn't have a place to lay his head. But the Bible said, the birds have nests, the foxes have holes, the Son of Man hath not a place to lay his head. And we're not going to get above our master. I heard James Mayer talking this morning about how that Jesus gave all. I believe he said going all in, I think it was
all
his
in.
Message.
All in.
Texas Hold.
Yeah. Did you watch it?
Yeah.
It's good. It'll be on again, they'll see it if you want to watch it again. And sometimes if I don't get it all, I watch it later in the evening. But he's going all in. He said he went all in for you. He laid it all out for you. And he did all this in the flesh and suffered in the flesh. And the pain and everything that went with it, he suffered it. And he did it willingly. Nobody made him do it. In fact, he made the statement to Pilate, I lay my life down. No man taketh it from me. I lay it down. And if I lay it down, I have power to take it back up again. Now, he wants you to know that as a believer, as a child of God, as a born-again child of God, you have the power to lay it down. You can walk away and leave it right now. And some do. But you have power to take it up again. You have power to retain it. You got power to keep it. He gave us the power to keep this thing. And what we have to do is grow in grace and knowledge of the Lord to the place that we can make this work.
But that's the key, is growing in grace and knowledge.
Yes.
You can't stay stagnant.
Can't stay stagnant.
If you stay stagnant, you cannot grow.
You can't grow.
You have to grow.
Yes.
And in order to grow, you have to be fed. You have to have that living water applied to your life.
Amen.
Amen.
And it's available. It's there all the time. And it's right under your nose.
Amen.
And it's being preached and spoken all the time. And you can just reject it. Well, what's these people talking about? You know, you're totally in the dark. Don't even know.
I'm so sorry.
That's okay, dear.
I watched that this morning, too. It just fired me. And he said, you know, I don't understand why people don't want Jesus. He gives you everything that you need. He gives you peace. He gives you love. He gives you joy. He gives you hope.
He said it all, didn't he?
He gives you all these things and people go, not interested.
Not interested.
Not interested. How can you not want something that's
And those
so
same people will cry on your shoulder about all the problems they got and everybody's against them and the whole world's against them and they can't seem to get anywhere. No matter how much money they got, it's not enough. And no matter how many possessions they got, it's not enough. No matter how many clubs they join or not satisfied or happy with. It's just total discontentment in the world. That's because they're not all in. They're not all in. You're not going to be content until you're all in.
Amen. Amen.
And you got to sell out. And you got to sell out. Amen. If God be God, let's serve God.
Amen.
You got to get that decided. First of all, if God really is God, and you're a servant of God, then let's serve God.
Amen.
Because that's where the peace is. That's where the joy is at. That's where the fullness of the gospel is.
Amen.
Amen. In knowing Him. How can we serve Him that we don't know? There are people serving a God they don't even know.
Yeah.
They haven't even come, amen, to terms with Him. You've got to come to terms with Him. Let me tell you something. I knew my father well before he died. We never was the best of friends. He didn't understand me at all. And I definitely didn't understand him. But I mean, he spent his life on a lot of things that I wouldn't even waste my time on. But it was big to him, and it's something to him. And he ended up with nothing. He chased the dollar. He chased position. And oh, he was a 32nd degree Mason. He was a, what do they call that other thing that's so big up there? That big Scottish Rite. Oh, yeah. He was in that. He was run with the governor. He was run with the politicians. Name a position. And they all let him down. In the end, when he didn't have anything to offer them, they didn't care anything about him. When he was in a position, he was assistant manager of a company, and he had something they needed, now they would raise his hand a little bit. So the first time he got down where he couldn't be a benefit to them, now all of a sudden he didn't mean anything to them. That was the greatest thing that he suffered through. He just couldn't believe that people would turn on him like they did. But they will. They absolutely will. Because men cannot be your Savior. It's impossible. There is a Savior named Jesus Christ. And he's all in for you, and you need to get all in for him. You know, when you get all in for him, then you're going to be heir to every promise that he's got. Praise the Lord. But until then, you're just going to be trying to figure out how you can be an heir to it. You gotta sell out somewhere along the line. Because the disciple's not above his master, but everyone that is perfect shall be his master. In other words, he said, you're not going to be Jesus' master, but you end up there with everybody else in the world is your master.
Right.
You're going to be subservient ending up to everybody around you because you tried to be your own. And he goes on to tell this little tale we've preached about many, many times. You've heard it taught and talked about. Why behold us now the mote that is in thy brother's eye, but perceivest not the beam that is in thine own eye. Now, how many times I've taught this through the years, I do not know. But it's nevertheless, it's true.
Amen.
Yes. It's just as true as the first time that I ever preached it. What people do when they can't measure up to what they want to be in God, they have to somehow bring themselves up. And to bring themselves up, they got to bring others down. Because in their mind, others are above them, so they got to bring them back. That's just the way men are. It's wrong. It's totally wrong.
Amen.
And it comes to nothing. But that's just the way men are. They think by tearing somebody else down somehow makes them look good. Now, I was talking to a brother the other day, and he was concerned because some had been some sins and things about him. I said, don't you know the people that know you right now, they understand and know what the situation truly is. You know, it's like, just to give an example, this is not all that much to you, but many of you have heard it many times. I never did drink. I don't care a thing about drinking. I'd love sort of have an iced tea. Now, I like to taste a beer, but now I've never tried to even bother to open one. But it just don't amount to nothing. But it was said that I was drunk. Now, to say guys are drunk and don't even care about the drink, that's way out there in it. And I played music in the clubs, and I've had them say, let me buy you a drink. And I said, well, put the money right down there, I'll get it later. And then when they go away, I'd stick it in my pocket. And I didn't get no drink because I didn't care about a drink. I'd be getting that Coca-Cola out of the machine on the way home after I got done. Or if I was real thirsty, I might drink one there, but very rarely. I generally, at the end of the shift, 3 o'clock in the morning, I'd stop somewhere in the film station and get me a Coke. But you could tell all day that I was a drunk, and I just laughed about that. I mean, that's so far-fetched from me, so far from me that anybody ever knew me, that you couldn't hardly make them believe it anyhow. Now, come on, you come to know people, don't you?
Absolutely.
You know, people say things about somebody, you know better than that. Come on, I know better than that. You know better than that. And that's the way it is. People go up saying anything they want to about you, but they don't make it so.
Amen.
Amen.
And if you know it's not so, it then ain't gonna bother you.
That's right.
And you know what people say right away? As I said this in the church before, there's a guy called the head of the organization. I was a carried papers with back in those days as a young minister, and told him all about me, what a rat I was and every kind of a thing. And he happened to be a new man. He hadn't been in office very long. He didn't even really know me. I'm way out in Knoxville, Iowa. And he called me and talked to me about it. He got such a kick out of it. He said, I thought you might like to know I got a letter here about you. I said, you did? He said, yeah. I said, oh my God, what did he tell you? He said, it don't matter. It doesn't matter. I read this and I said, these people got problems. Right away, he saw the bitterness and he saw what was there that shouldn't be there. And he said, I don't know you. I don't know about you. And I don't want that. This person wrote this letter and needs to go to home or somewhere. People are not stupid. And you go out against somebody and say anything you want to say. But right away, people know. Most people know. Don't hand me that. And so it generally shows up on you. It makes it look bad on you.
Amen.
When you go spreading around. Jesus was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and he opened not his mouth. He never said a word. In fact, when they accused him, he said, thou sayest. If you say, whatever you say about it, if you believe that, I guess, what can I do? And I'll tell you this, if you go up and tell something on me, if I go around chasing around trying to get it straightened out, you've probably gone and told something else. Now, I got another whole lot of stuff to try to straighten out. You can't do it.
Amen.
The best thing you do is just give it to God.
Amen.
Right? If your heart's clear, that's all that matters.
So good one time. He said, you know, a little boy went and told a bunch of lies about somebody with his mom, and he said, I'm so sorry that I said this. I know it's not true. How can I fix it? And she took a feather pillow and cut it open and shook it out the window, and the feathers went flying everywhere. And he said, what'd you do that for? And she said, then we'll pick up all the feathers. And he said, that's impossible. And he said, neither can you take back what you said, because once it's out there, you cannot.
It's broadcast.
Be careful what you speak with your mouth, because you can never take it all back.
You know, that's one of the greatest statements that's ever been said.
Amen.
Be careful, little mouth, what you say, because it might not be true.
Absolutely.
And some people very quick repeat things, and they don't know it's true or not.
Right.
So some rumor they heard somebody say it.
They're going to believe what they
want to
believe.
And most times, if you're the one that's doing that, it's looking bad on you.
Absolutely.
If I know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
I didn't really mean to get off on that, but it's true. These are very simple things that you have to come to grips with, because it'll stunt your growth. It'll stop you from getting where God wants you to go. Amen. So it said, so you look at this moat, which is just a particle of dust. Somebody said about like a little
twinkle.
Just a little bitty old spot of a thing.
I'm
and if you're not careful, you got a big tube of four sticking out of your eye. Yeah. A splinter, a sawdust. A stick of sawdust. And if you see it, some people are quick to see it. They'll see your fault. They know just exactly what you ought to do.
Sure.
They got it all figured out. Now what they ought to do, and they'll be quick to tell you. But sometimes they're telling you with a big old bean out of their eye. And how in the world can you see to pick a speck of dust out of a man's eye? You got a big old bean sticking out of your eye. That's a very simple thing, but it's very true.
Amen.
Anybody in here ain't got problems. See what you look like. Shortcut. Well, we got a liar in the crowd. Little Ronnie used to say that too. There's a liar in the crowd. The Bible said that we say we have no sin, and they got a liar.
Right.
We can't ought to do that, can we? Because we have this human flesh. And that's where the struggle is at. It's in this human flesh. But I tell you, as you get older, you get reach the age that I'm at, you find out a lot of stuff people get all worked up about don't amount to a hill of beans.
Amen.
You get all dredged up in your mind. See, it's a mind thing. And it'll stunt your growth and it'll cause you not to get where you want to get in God. I had an obese say to me one time, if you want to get big in God, you got to get little. I didn't understand what he was talking about, but today I do. I know exactly what he was saying. Bible said that Jesus made himself of no reputation. He went about doing good. He just went about doing good, and he didn't have no press releases. He didn't have nobody promoting him. Nobody speaking for him. And anybody would say anything, he'd say, well, just pray for them. They know not what to do. Folks, I'll tell you, there's so much in the simplicity of this gospel. It's so simple.
Amen.
That we don't have to err in this thing. The truth is so plain to see. God sent us to save one person. And that's me.
Amen.
Sent you to save you. And you can be a witness to many.
Yes.
But you can't save them.
You cannot.
You cannot be their savior. In fact, you can waste a lot of time and a lot of effort trying to get people to do what you think they ought to do. And they're going to pretty much do what they want to do.
Amen.
Now what we got to do somehow is get a better want to.
Amen.
We need to get a better want to.
Amen.
Amen. I had a friend, he was an old bishop, 66 years. What a great, wonderful man. He wrote a song one time, I think it's the only really big song he wrote, but he wrote a lot of songs. But he wrote a song, to be like Jesus, to be like Jesus, on earth I long to be like him. All through life's journey, from here to glory, I only ask to be like him. His name was Reverend Newton, and he was quite a minister up in the north central part of Indiana. Praise the Lord. Another song he wrote was, are you in the church triumph? Are you in the Savior's bride? Come and be baptized into the body and forevermore abide. That was it. He was a great man. I got to spend a lot of time with him as a young minister. And he taught me a lot of things. At that time, I was in a war because I was sitting under a ministry where everybody had a devil. There was every kind of a devil you could think of. I mean, there was hairdo devils. There was every kind of a devil you could think of. You got a devil, I got a devil, all of God's children got a devil. And it bothered me, it was getting so bad in my church, we heard more teaching about the devil than we did anything else. Devil's going to get you for this. God's going to get you for that. The devil's out to get you. The devil's on your trail. The devil did. The devil there. Every time anybody did anything that was out of order, it was the devil. Had to be the devil.
The devil made
me
do it.
Yeah, the devil made me do it. Oh, devil made me do that. But I sit down and talk to this old man, he said, I'm going to tell you something, Brother Davis. I've been doing this for 66 years, and I've seen maybe two or three people that was absolutely possessed of the devil. And I'll say my number somewhere else in that area. I've seen some. I've had to talk to them. I had to talk to the devil with them. And they spoke back to them. Yeah, I've seen a few of them. But I mean, they're so far gone and they're so wrapped up in things, atrocious, evil, wicked things, you couldn't even imagine. But he said, I'm going to tell you something, Brother Davis. Children of God don't have devils.
Amen.
They got weaknesses. They have shortcomings. They have their faults and their failures. But they don't have devils.
Amen.
Because God and the devil can't take up the same space.
Amen.
And when Jesus comes in and takes the devil out, he has no more room in there. And he can't get back in.
Amen.
He's sealed. He cannot get in. I don't care what anybody tells you. Amen. When they start that devil stuff, That's just out of their mind.
The Bible says we're drawn away by the lust of the flesh.
You're drawn away of your own lust.
Yes.
Your own lust, not somebody else's lust. Your own lust. We got nothing to deal with our lust without me trying to work your lust out.
Amen. Amen.
We all got our own deals we got to deal with.
Amen.
And we got to deal with them.
Yes.
And we got to work with them. Oh, we got to work at it. Oh, we got to resist the devil.
Yep.
And he'll flee. Boy, he'll flee, the Bible says. But we got to truly resist him. We have to recognize him and know. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Now, Jesus talked to the devil one time, didn't he?
Right.
Get behind me, Satan, he said.
Yes.
Just because he was talking to the negative. Them words is coming out of your mouth coming straight to the devil. That ain't God talking there. How would you like that? Somebody talk to you like that. But nevertheless, we all have that to deal with in our growth in God. And this is the thing, children, we, some of us have been around this a long time. It's time we start growing.
Amen.
We got to grow in grace and knowledge.
Amen.
I know what I know because I've grown. And sometimes against my own will, you don't want to grow. But I never said, I want to get medicated. He's going to dedicate him. He's a little bit older before his mother got him to come and get dedicated. He said, I don't want to get medicated. I said, you're going to get medicated anyhow, kid. You got to get medicated if you don't want to get medicated. Amen. I got so many thoughts going through my mind right now. Sometimes I'm like exploding with bombs going off in my mind. I got to be careful. I don't get off. I want to get up. Either how can I say that, brother, let me pull out the mote that is in thine eye, but thou thyself beholdest not the beam that is in thine own eye. Thou hypocrite, cast out first the beam out of thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to pull out the mote that is in thy brother's eye. And I really believe when you get to that point where you can see clearly, you see clearly that you're not supposed to pull it out of their own eye. You understand me? You see, you can see clearly to pull it out. And by that time you come to realize it's not my place to pull it out.
Amen.
That's right. We've got the power.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
We got the power in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Said a good tree bringeth not forth corrupt fruit. Neither does a corrupt tree bringeth forth good fruit. For every tree is known by his own fruit. For of thorns men do not gather figs, nor of a bramble bush gather the grapes. A good man, out of the goodness, out of the treasure of his heart, bringeth forth that which is good. And an evil man, out of the evil treasure of his heart, bringeth forth that which is evil. For of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. Now, there are people that don't really believe that evil exists. There are people that people are trying to help that they're just evil. And they think just giving a few shots or giving a few pills or is going to help them. Yeah, psychopathic people. There are people you cannot help. I don't care how bad. And I'm not saying God couldn't help. God can do anything. And he has done it. He has been known to do it.
Amen.
I heard a man testify of it one time, and he was telling me he checked into this motel. He became a very prominent man and well-known man in this city. I heard him give this testimony. He had checked into motels. He was going to kill himself. And he was an atheist. in living God. Said he did. He lay there on his bed and he warred and he fought God and warred and fought with God all night. And the God came down upon him and overshadowed him. I can't make it big enough the way he could tell it. He could stand a church on end just giving this testimony. How the God came down and poured out his love upon him. I understand that because I've told you about God pouring his love out upon me. And he found grace with God. Hallelujah. And he said the Lord spoke to him details and he gave him scripture. And he had a little Bible there. He didn't know no. He had to look it up. Didn't even know where it was at. But God details. He spoke it to him. So I mean he got an absolute miracle from God. He appeared to him in the room as a great light. Because for this man, and in the shape that he was in, it was the only thing it would take.
Yes, amen.
An absolute move of God himself. And he did it. You know, God will come down off his throne if he has to.
Amen.
But this man had come to the end of his wits. He didn't know what to do. So he was, in effect, he was offering himself. He didn't realize he was, but he was. He was actually offering himself. Here I am. What can I do? I'm ready to destroy myself. Of course, he really didn't want to do that. And nevertheless, he was to that point. That's the breaking point. That's the point of decision. That's the point where the rubber meets the road. That's the point called, I believe Jesus called it the bones and the marrow, or the joint and the marrow. It's down to where it's at. Some people, it's hard to get to where they're at because they got such a facade put up. They got such a phony front up that you can't get to them. And they've learned how to send them under the Word of God and just let it roll off like a water on a duck's back. And they grow hardened. And the ground is fallow. You know what fallow ground is? It's old, hard, crusty ground. Like what they find in the spring when they go out and begin to put the plows into the ground. And that crust begins to come up. That's that old fallow ground. Can't put any seed in on that ground. But it's hard as a rock. It's got a thing built up against that seed. That seed lay there and die on top of that ground. That ground has to be broken up. So you got to get a plow out there and dig that ground up. Then you got to let it set a little bit. Then you got to come back with a disc and chop it into fine bits. And now it's ready for the seed to go in. It's done been broken up. God is trying to get some of us broken up to where he can plant that seed within us. I tell you, when I found the Lord, I was so ready for him. I got a money. I was at the end of my rope. I had to have something different than what I had. I often wonder why people don't get tired of the way that they live and the way they go through. When a change is so much better to make changes, and God will change you. Amen. But you have to offer yourself to be changed. This whole thing is a work of change. Our whole life is a work of change. We change from year to year. We change from decade to decade. Our lives change. That's why people grow apart sometimes. Because one grows and the other doesn't. Yeah? That's why it's important, amen, as married folks, to walk together with God.
Amen.
You see something?
Yeah, Brother Hank, when I worked at Methodist years ago, there was a man and he was dying and he said, "He was atheist." And I went
said, God bless you. He said, get out of here. Get out of here. Get out of here. Scream. And when he died, he screamed. It was horrible. He died. And he would not listen. And that's the way people are nowadays. They better wake up and listen what God is speaking to us. But that happened and it was horrible. I had to see him die.
Oh, it's a real situation. You can tell that difference when a believer dies.
Amen.
They just go to sleep. They just go to rest in the arms of Jesus. Amen. Praise the Lord. But that process begins now. It began the day you accepted Christ. And it's supposed to grow in grace and knowledge in you. And it's supposed to bring you to an understanding of Him and who He is and what He's about. You know, some people are easy fooled because they don't really know Him. People can come along and paint them a picture and they'll just buy it because they don't really know Him. But if you've grown in grace and knowledge of the Lord, you're going to say, don't try to tell me that about the Lord. I know the Lord. I know better than that. That's not the Spirit of the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord is, first of all, it's lovely.
Lovely, yeah.
Paul said,
He is lovely.
Easy to be entreated. I mean, you can deal with it. You can go to God and He'll receive you. He said, He that cometh unto me, I will no wise cast out.
Amen.
So if people want to stand up and give you a slug in the name of the Lord, you know that ain't God.
Amen.
Or if people want to bite your head off or cast judgment upon you, or what do they want to do? That's not God.
Amen.
That's just not the way of the Lord. See, there is a time for judgment. He will come back as a God of judgment.
Yes.
After He takes His church out of here and His grace is lifted from the earth, He'll come back as a God of judgment. And He will cast judgment upon the earth. And He'll be righteous judgment. You can count on that. But we're in a day of grace now. God looks at us through the blood. He looks at us saved ones through the blood. Thank you, Jesus. He couldn't even look on us if it wasn't for the blood. Because God can't look upon sin.
Amen.
So He sees us through the blood. Aren't you glad about that?
Amen.
Amen. That means it doesn't matter how old you go, you can still approach God. How far you drift away, you can still approach God. When you come to the understanding and you realize I need to move up in my life.
Amen.
And only you can decide that.
Amen.
And I can tell you on my own personal behalf, I come to a place where I couldn't go on the way I was going. I had to find some peace. I had to find some joy. And I knew it was in Him. And I was in a war all the time. And most of it was my own making. I didn't understand that. But the time came that I had to find peace. I went far as I could go. And I surrendered myself. There comes a time of surrender. You have to surrender your will. You have to surrender your goals. Your goals have to become, His goals have to become your goals. Amen. He's got a will for your life. He wants you to find that will. It's very simple. In the end, it's to reach others. It's to be a witness. It's to be a witness upon the earth. And He's given us all that ability to be that witness. He's given us the power to, through the power of the Holy Ghost. He's given it to us through the gifts of the ministry. The fivefold ministry is available to us. And all that can make us available to do what we need to do in God. John, I know this might have been a little bit different for you today, but it's so important. I came to a place in my situation where I knew I wasn't growing. I was just running in place. You may be there today, but God can help you to find what you need in Him. Everything you need is available in Him. You won't find it out here in some man. You won't find it in some evangelistic association. It's in Him that we live and move and have our being. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And He loves us all, children. He is not our opponent. He saved us and He didn't bring us out here to die. But He's given us the power to grow in grace and knowledge of the Lord. God bless you today.
Thank you.
Okay, Sunday school. Sunday school teachers, raise your hands.
Mindy and me.
Okay. Mindy, what do you
do? We
had our class together and made Mother's Day cards.
And flowers.
Brother Ryan?
We made Mother's Day kids. We learned how to get the beauty from the inside to the outside.
Did you have any luck?
They're going to be good all day.
Still is, always is. Sister Victoria?
She didn't
teach. Oh, you didn't teach? Oh, sorry. I'm sorry. And again, the Dollar family. Next Sunday. They're finally going to be here. Seems like it's been every week before. I don't know how long it's been in the paper. Start next Sunday through the 23rd, the Dollar family will be here.
And the Dollar family.
It's going to have a good time.
You love the Dollar.
Yeah, they're
down home.
Exactly.
In
down
Alabama.
Down home people. How did the food drive go yesterday?
Wonderful.
Yes.
Thank you for being here.
Monday morning at 9 o'clock at the first Baptist Church.
Sorting tomorrow.
You
hear that, people?
9 o'clock.
9 o'clock. After that, we're going to be sorting.
Over by the high school.
By the high school.
9 o'clock.
Our attendance this morning was 48, and our tithe and offering was $380. Yes, ma'am. Georgina has an announcement.
I have announced, we're going to start choir back up next week. After Sunday school, we'll start it back up. Lisa said she'll be here to help us. So we're just going to redo a couple songs, get used to them, and then we're going to start doing some new ones. So everybody, please come out and be a help. How Misty will you? And Zach?
For your mommy.
Huh? You want me to do that now? Or
I'm having a
Would that give you time to get a little okay? Thank you. Okay. At this time, we'll have our special speaker come up. Sister Wendy. Come on.
Do you
want to hear it,
sir?
That's your first word.
I know. Yeah, I know. Praise the Lord. If you turn to 2 Kings chapter 4. And I got up this morning thinking about Indian Mother's Day, and you know, while I was getting ready and taking my shower and all that, and thinking about the mothers of the Bible, you know, God was just going over that in my head, my soul, about the various mothers, about Ruth, you know, and when her sons died, and how Naomi stayed with her, or she stayed with, I got them backwards, didn't I? Yeah, Ruth stayed with Naomi when Naomi's sons died, and Orpah went out, and, you know, and then we've got, of course, Mary, and there's various different mothers in the Bible, and I had no clue that I was going to be asked to speak this morning, but, you know, I was like, it's Mother's Day, you know, it's great to exemplify a mother in the Bible today, and I was just thinking over various ones, and then got here and was asked to speak, and I'm like, Lord, you started that way before I ever got here. And so in 2 Kings, you know, I thought about all the different ones, and in 2 Kings, I've always spent a lot of time in 1 Kings and 2 Kings with Elijah and Elisha. Me and Brother Ronnie loved Elijah and Elisha and had many, many great conversations on them. And I was drawn back to this passage with Elisha, and starting at verse 8, and it said, "And it fell on a day that Elisha passed to Shunem,
where was a great woman, and she constrained him to eat bread. And so it was that as oft as he passed by, he turned in thither to eat bread. And she said unto her husband, Behold, now I perceive that this is a holy man of God, which passes by us continually. Let us make a chamber, I pray thee, on the wall, and let us set for him there a bed, and a table, and a stool, and a candlestick. And it shall be when he cometh to us that he shall turn in thither. And it fell on a day that he came thither, and he turned into the chamber and lay there. And he said to Gehazi, his servant, Call the Shunammite. And when he had called her, she stood before him. And he said unto him, Say now unto her, Behold, thou hast been careful for us with all this care. What is to be done for thee? Wouldest thou be spoken for to the king or to the captain of the host? And she answered, I dwell among my own people. And he said, What then is to be done for her? And Gehazi answered, Verily she hath no child, and her husband is old. And he said, Call her. And when he had called her, she stood in the door. And he said, About this season, according to the time of life, thou shalt embrace a son. And she said, Nay, my lord, thou man of God, do not lie unto thine handmaid. And the woman conceived and bare a son at that season that Elisha had said unto her, according to the time of life. Now this was a lady who was older in age, past her time of season of having a child, had no child. Her husband was older as well. But she recognized Elisha as a man of God. And she treated Elisha respectfully. She made sure that he was fed, he had a place to sleep, he was taken care of when he came through. So when, after so many times of coming through and her taking such good care of him, he was like, What can I do for you? And she basically said nothing. I dwell with my people. I'm here with my people. I'm just doing what I need to do. I don't need nothing extra from you. So instead of doing some great miraculous work, you know, or talking to a king or something right then and there on the spot, he told her, said, You're going to have a child. Because, of course, by them not having a child, there was no inheritance to go on. There was no name to pass on. That family was not going to move forward. So he knew that. So you're going to have a child. She's like, don't lie to me. And I'm sure she had spent her whole life, wishing and hoping and longing for a child she never had. And she's past the age of having a child. And he tells her, you're going to have a child, just like Abraham and Sarah. But Elisha tells her, you're going to have a child. She's like, don't lie to me, you man of God. Do not tell me that I'm going to have a child when I know physically I can't. Don't lie to me. Don't get my hopes up. You're a man of God. You shouldn't be doing that. But you know what? He didn't lie to her. He gave her a blessing. He gave her a son. And she had a son. And it says, going on, and when the child was grown, it fell on a day that went out to his father, to the reapers. And he said unto his father, My head, my head. And he said to a lad, Carry him to his mother. The child became sick. And where did the child go? Back to his mother. Who was going to be there to care for that child, to love that child, and take care of him but his mother? And when he had taken him and brought him to his mother, he sat on her knees till noon and then died. She sat there and cared for him and held him. And then he passed away. And she went up and laid him on the bed of the man of God. She went to the chamber that was built for the man of God and laid her dead son, the promise from Elisha. The promise that Elisha had given her, that had been fulfilled, that had now died in her arms, she laid him on the man of God's bed and shut the door upon him and went out. And she called unto her husband and said, Send me, I pray thee, one of the young men and one of the asses, that I may run to the man of God and come again. And he said, Wherefore wilt thou go to him today? It is neither new moon nor Sabbath. And she said, it shall be well. Then she saddled an ass and said to her servant, drive and go forward. Slack not thy riding for me, except I bid thee. So she went and came unto the man of God to Mount Carmel. And it came to pass, when the man of God saw her afar off, that he said to Gehazi his servant, behold, yonder is that Shunammite. Run now, I pray thee, to meet her, and say unto her, it is well with thee? Is it well with thy husband? Is it well with thy child? And she answered, it is well. On her way, she said, it shall be well. When she got to where the man of God was, she said, it is well. This lady had been given a promise. She had been given a promise of a child past her season. She had been given that child, and that child had grown. She had cared for this child. She had nurtured this child. She had raised this child. She had been given a promise of God. And now, all of a sudden, that promise seemed to have died in her arms. We as Christians are given promises of God. And we as Christians sometimes look at our promise and we look like, it looks like it has died in our arms. She decided she had a promise. She was determined to know that that promise was going to be fulfilled, that God would not take that promise away from
Amen.
Her.
Amen.
And she went on. And she said, it shall be well. Because I'm not yet to the man of God who can help me. But I know as soon as I get to that man of God, it will be well. It may not be well at this very moment. It may not be well where I stand. It may not be well in my soul, but I will tell you, no matter what's going on, it shall be well.
Hallelujah.
And that's what this lady said. She was a mother who had a promise, who was standing on that promise. She stood on that promise and was not going to give up, that God was going to give her a son, and God was not going to take that away. When she got to where the man of God was in Mount Carmel, she told Gehazi, his servant, it is well. I have arrived. I have made it. It is well now because I am here. I am standing on my promise that this man of God is going to make my son whole. And when she came to the man of God to the hill, she caught him by the feet. But Gehazi came near to thrust her away. And the man of God said, let her alone, for her soul is vexed within her. And the Lord hath hid it from me, and hath not told me. God was not showing him what was going on. Now God does that to us too.
Yes.
He will not show us everything. All he knew was something was wrong with her. She would not answer anything else but say, it is well. He asked, is everything okay with your husband, with your child, with you? All she would say is, it is well. I'm standing on the faith of my promise
Amen.
That everything
Amen.
Is well.
Amen.
He didn't know what was going on, but he knew that she was holding on to him with every ounce of faith she had, knowing that he could make it right.
Amen.
Then she said, did I desire a son of my Lord? Did I not say, do not deceive me? Then he had said to Gehazi, gird up thy loins and take my staff in thy hand and go thy way. If thou meet any man, salute him not. And if any salute thee, answer him not again. And lay my staff upon the face of the child. And the mother of the child said, as the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. And he arose and followed her. And Gehazi passed on before them and laid the staff upon the face of the child, that there was neither voice nor hearing. Wherefore he went again to meet him and told him, saying, the child is not wakened. And when Elisha was come into the house, behold, the child was dead and laid upon his bed. He went in therefore and shut the door upon them twain and prayed unto the Lord. Sometimes we take a message from God, and we take that message and we take it out ahead of God. And that message does not always become fruitful. Gehazi took the staff of Elisha and took it ahead of Elisha. But that was not God's will in that case. Sometimes we get ahead of ourselves. We get ahead of God. We get ahead of what God wants us to do. And then we fall flat on our face. The child did not awaken when the staff was laid upon him, because that's not the way it was supposed to work. We need to stay in God's will. And that mother stood on the promise still and said, I'm not going to leave your side. She knew that the man of God was going to save her son. And when Elisha was coming to the house, behold, the child was dead and laid upon his bed. And he went in therefore and shut the door upon them twain and prayed unto the Lord. And he went up and lay upon the child and put his mouth upon mouth and his eyes upon his eyes and his hands upon his hands. And he stretched himself upon the child, and the flesh of the child waxed warm. Then he returned and walked in the house to and fro, and went up and stretched himself upon him. And the child sneezed 7 times, and the child opened his eyes. And he called Gehazi and said, call this Shunammite. So he called her, and when she was come in unto him, he said, take up thy son. Then she went in and fell at his feet and bowed herself to the ground and took up her son and went out. She held to a promise.
Amen.
And personally for me today, I want to honor all the mothers who have held to a promise over the years. Mothers and grandmothers and great-grandmothers alike. Aunts. Anyone who has been a mother figure to a child. You don't have to be that child's biological mother at all. This woman here had been given a promise of a child that died in her arms, but was revived again by her faith and her standing on the promise of God that she would have that child. We are given as mothers so many promises of God for our children and for our family. And thank God, we as mothers can stand on those promises and hold God to those promises to save our children and to save our family. There have been so many mothers, grandmothers, aunts, cousins even, whoever they are in someone's life that has prayed the prayer of faith to save the lost in their family. The children that may not be their child, but the children who are lost, who don't have God in their life. You know, these are the women today that we honor on Mother's Day. I had a praying grandma in my life. I did. I had a praying mama when I was younger, definitely. She's still a praying mama. She's just a little not here in this church sometimes, but she's still out there. But my grandmother was a praying grandma, and I grew up with her, pretty much. I did. I lived with her all summer, every summer, most of the school year, especially after I got middle and high school, when I could just walk from her house to school. My grandmother prayed. My grandmother prayed for her children, for her grandchildren, for her great-grandchildren. And I thank God today that my grandma was a woman of God. Because that's what I want to honor today, is the women of God in our lives. My grandma knew, by my dad being a preacher and an evangelist, I did not have stability in my life when it came to church and God. We went from one church to another, and every church we went to was different. I went to a church that didn't believe in women wearing pantyhose. I went to a church that you couldn't wear a bit of jewelry except for a ring. I went to another church, I had to take this off. One believed in oneness, one believed in holiness. You name it, I went to it. Backwoods of Ohio, the mountains of West Virginia, you name it, I went to it. I was here, there, and everywhere else every other weekend. But my grandma was a praying woman of God. My grandma knew I did not have that stability in my life. My grandma hunted for stability, not only for herself, but for her grandchild. I went to several different churches with my grandma around here. Brother and Sister Hills Church, Church of God, when it was down there, went there. I went to singing competitions with them and different things, but it wasn't home. It was a Pentecost by any means. And that's what I grew up in. I went to Brother Boland's church way down by the, down by where Pizza Hut used to be, 2nd Street or whatever. Down that way, we went to Brother Whit Farron's. I even went to Brother Potter's for a time. I went here, there, and everywhere. And that was until Brother Pat and Sister Daisy opened up this church. But my grandma wanted to keep me stable. She wanted to find me a place that I could be taught the Word of God by stable people. She knew that these people could influence my life and influence the growth of God in me. And she made sure, as much as she could, that she provided that stability in my life. And you know, this morning I want to say thank you. Thank you to my grandma, who's not here anymore. But I want to say thank you to all of you women of God, who have taken that time, taken that effort to put stability and put God in your children. Because without a woman of God in a child's life, that child can be empty. You fill a void in them and you teach them so much and so lovingly that they'll never forget.
You know, as Wendy was speaking, I was thinking of Mary, the mother of Jesus, what she went through. You know, she was conceived of the Holy Ghost and she gave a virgin birth, but even though she knew who Jesus was, she raised him up all his life. He was still her son.
Yes.
And when she seen him hanging on the cross, I think about the Passion of Christ. Y'all seen that? Where she was thinking back when Jesus was a little boy and he fell and she went running to his and to pick him up and help him. But that time, you know, she couldn't be there. She couldn't help him that time. He had to do that last mile on his own, so to speak. I was thinking about her. We need to get water through her also in the way, but not expensive. You know, thank God. I love Jesus. I pray for her when you're done. I just couldn't help not thinking about her this time. But anyway, this morning we have a couple of gifts up here. Three, matter of fact, to give to the oldest, the youngest, and the mother with the most children. Now, I want to see the hand of the oldest mother here this morning. What would that be?
Mom's 84.
84?
I think she's got it.
I think you might be the...
You can
get us,
give your testimony.
You'll come up and give
a testimony. Well, she
does. This is a special day for me.
Yes, it
is. I'm happy to be here. And I'm glad that I'm praying. Amen. It's been 2 or 3 years since I received the baptism of the Holy Ghost.
Bless her, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
So it's just as real today
as it was.
Yes.
And you know, he started opening doors when I got saved. That I thought I was the most miserable person in the world before I got saved. And I really was. And I'm thankful because it led me to pray and to trust the Lord. And so there's nothing impossible with God.
Amen.
He's real. And he's the just as real today. And he's more real to me, like Brother David said. We're getting... Well, I'm sure
little
we're getting ready to know to cross over. We want to truly be ready.
Amen.
And we can be ready.
Amen.
Praise the Lord for each and every one of you all. We're cheering this morning. I hope you have a good day. Enjoy your children. It doesn't matter what they're at. God knows where they're
at.
Amen. Amen. Bless you, Lord. I want to see the youngest mother this morning.
Unless there's somebody
over
33.
I am.
You can't
be
lying. That's what they're under
there. She had nothing to say this morning. I am thankful for being a mother. You know, I mean, they really. They say I couldn't have had one, but you know what? God made it possible. He made a way where there seemed to be no way.
Amen.
You know, and I love my baby every day. It just ain't my mother's day. I love her every day.
Sure.
You know, more and more every day.
Sure.
You know, I may not be the best mother in the world, but I love her.
Yes. Thank you. The mother with the most children. That's going to be a toss-up.
Children.
Well, I hope all you mothers have a good day today. A blessed day. Shall we all stand?